All right, if you have your Bible then with you, I'd ask you to turn to the book of James, James chapter 5, and we're going to begin reading in verse 15. James chapter 5, and we'll begin in verse 15. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We thank you for your blessings on our church, Lord. We pray for the upcoming services, Lord, that it might be the beginning of your movement here in this place. Lord, we pray for the people of Dover. Lord, everything is taken under the name of religion, Lord, but we pray that you would make them understand that empty, dry religion is nothing if you don't move. Lord, we pray that you would draw people to yourself, that as our church here would be stirred up for your service, Lord, that we might even see those that would be saved by your mercy and grace. Bless your word to the hearts and the hearers. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching this evening on the thought, do you pray in faith? Do you pray in faith? Now, I'll say first of all, most of what we attribute to prayer today isn't. Most of what we are calling prayer is nothing more than routine. And you really can't say in the immediate that you've met with God. Now, sometimes we can feel the Holy Spirit and understand that He has met with us, but is that really prayer, or is He blessing you by His presence? And there is a difference. Now, back in verse 15, the Bible says, and the prayer of faith. Now, again, I always point this out because it doesn't say the faith, those oracles and truth handed from God to His men, but it says the prayer of faith. Confidence, belief, trust, that type of prayer. And so I guess the first thing that I would ask, do you pray with that kind of faith? Do you pray with, well, you know, I'm going to throw this out here, and whatever will be, or do you pray with faith, believing that it will come to pass? And there is a huge difference. And so you want to see the sick healed, pray in faith. You want to see souls saved, pray in faith. You want to see people added to New Testament church, pray in faith. That is what we, as the Lord's people, are to do. He says, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. Now, two things. Number one, I want you to see that the prayer of faith does save the sick, but the raising up is a work of God. We can't do that. You see these people, you know, they're supposedly lame and preachers pulling them up. That's a work of God. If He raises them up, that's a work of God, not a work of man. But faith is everything. You know why people get discouraged? They lack faith. You know why people quit coming to church? They lack faith. You know why people aren't excited about coming before they get here? They lack faith. They lack faith. If you don't believe something's going to happen when you get down to the house of God, you lack faith. You're not trusting in what He's promised to do. Then He says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another. He gives us two commands, and the first one is to confess your faults. You know, and even in a church as small as this, it's very easy to get enmity against someone else. You know what? We're not all the same, and nor will we ever be. But the Lord's people should set that aside. What is the Bible says we're brothers and sisters in Christ, does it not? Me and my brother and my sister, every one of us, we're completely different. And all of you know, all of you that know us know that. We're completely different. But you know what? We're still brothers and sisters. And we're everyone here different. And you know what? You don't know any more than anybody else. You've not arrived, nor will you ever arrive in this life. So what we need to do is to pull together and treat one another like brothers and sisters. That's why that's there. And then he says that we are to confess your faults one to another. Now, you know, I know this about myself, and I'm willing to confess it. I have a short fuse. That's not bragging, but at least I'll admit it. What I found, most people don't admit their faults. Some people have sharp tongues. You know what they need to do? They need to admit it and pray God might help them with it. You know what I pray? I pray God make my fuse longer because I know that's what I need. I don't need to be so quick to react. But it's very hard to say, you know what? I'm doing that wrong. Because you know what? It's much easier to say you're doing it. Is it not? But he said he wasn't worried about what other people had to do. He says, confess your faults. I know my faults better than you do. Confess the faults that I see within myself. Confess your faults one to another, and then pray one for another. So you know what that says to me? If you're carrying around all this baggage, your prayers aren't doing much. Because confess your faults one to another and pray one for another. So that, in other words, we can't approach the throne of grace when we have enmity against one another. We have to confess that, make it right, and then and only then will our prayers be effectual. So he says, confess your faults one to another and pray ye one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now, let me say this, ladies, and I usually don't get into interpretation. The Bible says what it says, but that word does mean person. One of the few places. In other words, that's a job for women, and that's a job for men, is the work of prayer. We are everyone responsible for that. And we, everyone, ought to be doing it for one, for another, for the church, for me as your pastor. It should be a work that we all gladly do together. Now, the promise here is that it availeth much. It does things. It causes things to happen. It inspires God. It gives Him this. And listen, you're not going to put any ideas into the head of God. In the head of God, He's all knowing. But I will say this: He wants your prayers. And if nothing else, it brings this sinful, ungodly, prideful flesh down to nothing. And that's exactly where it needs to be. Really, it needs to be less than nothing. And so we see then that we, if we want an effective prayer life, then we're going to have to approach it this way. Now, when it says Elias, that is just the Greek way to write that, but it is talking of the man of Elijah. And we're going to look back to the references that it's making to him just for a few minutes. And I want you to see, it was a man that says that he was a man subject to like passions, feelings, as we are. Now, in other words, he was no different than us. He had the same stuff, made out of the same stuff, had the same opposition, had the same thoughts, had the same flesh to deal with. He was like us. And we'll find that his prayer life was very, very remarkable. You know, I dare say this. Most of us don't have remarkable prayer lives, and most of us have never met anybody that did. Would you say the first statement? A remarkable prayer life. And we'll find about a man that did, and how this looks, the way that Peter reminds them, he prayed that it rained not, and it rained not for the space of 3.5 years. So how was he measuring his prayer life? By results, was he not? He was measuring the prayer life by results. So how do you measure yours? Now, well, God is sovereign, and if He's sovereign, if He wants it to happen, it'll happen. And listen, I understand that. I know God is sovereign, and I know God does what He own will. But I also know this. Peter measured Elijah's prayer life by what happened. Did he not? And so we see then that maybe that's what we need to do, is measure our prayer life by results. Measure our prayer life by what occurs. Elisha was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. That is an effective prayer life. Go with me to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 17 in the first verse. 1 Kings 17 in the very first verse, the Bible says, Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these 3 years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying. Now, I want you to notice two things. First of all, this is the very first time you ever hear Elijah mentioned. There's no for information from him, no leading into information. The first thing, he went to the ruler and said, listen, it's not going to rain until I say it's going to rain. And he walked out. See, but we know there had to be preparatory work to that, right? He knew there had to be a relationship with God. He had to know something about prayer. He had to know God at some point spoke to him, according to James, we just read that somewhere along the way God spoke to him and said, you go and tell them. Somewhere he spoke, and in fact it says that Elijah prayed that it wouldn't rain. And we don't find an accounting of this, but we know it did. The word's right, right? And so, could you imagine praying for our home nation as we said, God, do not let it rain in our land. Most of us wouldn't dare to pray that because you know why? We'd be suffering too. He prayed that knowing full well what the results would be. See, most of us, that tells me the first thing of hindrances in our prayer is that we want to be comfortable. He was really praying for judgment on himself as much as he was for everyone else. He says, get to the brook of Cherith, and I've commanded that the ravens feed thee there. Look with me in verse 3. Get thee hence and turn thee eastward and hide thyself in the brook Cherith, which is before Jordan. It shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, and he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. Now, I want you to see that men who sincerely pray hear from God. Men who sincerely pray, women who sincerely pray hear from God. And if you don't hear from God, something is wrong with your prayer life. Either you're lost and you don't really know Him, or you're not praying in the right spirit. One of the two. It can't be any other way. And so we see then that as He gives, somewhere before, again, He had to pray because the Bible says in James that He prayed that it wouldn't rain. So He had already prayed about that. Now He gets a command from God and says, I want you to go down to Cherith. And you stay there until I tell you different. And His plan, I'm going to have the ravens come and bring you something to eat. Brother Ashley's back there with 5 boys. What if it was God's plan to feed all 5 of them youngins, and the only command you had is you sit here and wait for the ravens to come? You talk about testing your faith.
Yeah.
I know Brother Ashley does, and all the fathers. I take it very serious. My responsibility to be sure that they are fed. I take it a very serious thing. But if what God's plan was, you just do this by faith. I'll take care of the rest. You just trust me. So we see then that he had a relationship with God in which that he had learned to trust and depend on God in a great deal. Drop down to verse 17. And it came to pass after these things that the son of the woman, now the woman is the widow that he had went to, the brook of Cherith dried up. He says, you go to a widow woman, you join yourself unto her, and I'm going to get her to take care of you for the rest of this time. Now that happened, we know that it did, and the little boy died. The little boy was no longer with him. Verse 18. Verse 17, and it came to pass after these things that the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, fell sick, and his sickness was sore, that there was no breath left in him. And she said unto Elijah, what have I to do with thee, O man of God? Art thou come unto me to call my sin to remembrance and to slay my son? Now, I want you to notice a couple of things. First of all, it did say the mistress of the house. That's the same word we use mistress for, too. There's no loss in translation. She wasn't married. Her baby daddy, in the modern day, that's the kind of woman she was. And she says, have you called this to me? Have you done this to point out my sin? Has that boy's life been taken because he was illegitimate? Because he didn't belong to his... Why have you done to this? You know, that's a good thing about judgment. And it should be, it calls you to think about what you've done. Now, in the modern day, I don't see a lot of that. Do you? Do you like sermons that make you think, that could be me? That's what she was thinking, you know. What have I done? How did I contribute to the death of my son? And then we see the hopelessness of the situation as well. I can't really remember. I've asked this many times, and I have to keep asking because I forget. How many people have seen someone die, take their last breath? It's something you'll never forget. Could you imagine seeing one of your babies take their last breath? That's what this woman had experienced. And you know what would have to be, in my mind, the hopelessness of the situation, that there was really nothing left to be done, nothing that could be done. It was over, it was finished. That's how I would feel. But no, notice what this praying man does. And he, meaning Elijah, said unto her, give me thy son. And he took him out of her bosom and carried him up into a loft where he abode. And he laid him upon his own bed. And he cried unto the Lord and said, O Lord my God, hast thou also brought evil upon the widow with whom I have sojourned by slaying her son? Now I want you to see that that wasn't a command. It was a question. And you know what? God would have been just and right in saying, yes, you hit it, Elijah. You're right on. But he didn't. So when we're praying about something, consider the situation. You know why? Because you don't know everything. You don't know what the situation is. You don't know what the background of that is. And what we should really just pray is, Lord, what's your will? Is this the reason why? And what I have found in prayer life for myself, if I can understand and just accept whatever God says is right, if I can get to that point, my prayer life is easier. Verse 21, and he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried unto the Lord and said, Oh Lord my God, I pray thee, let this child's soul come into him again. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came unto him again, and he revived. Now, that is just regular prayer. Now, we'll find a couple of things about Elijah's prayer life, and this is one of the key ones. He did not give up. He kept praying. Now, of all my people that seen folks leave this world, how many people have touched a dead body, I mean, before it's laid out in the funeral home? I mean, just a freshly dead body. Very specific feeling, isn't it? Could you lay on one? His servant Elisha would lay on one face to face like this. And he did it three times. You know what? When you touch a corpse and it's cold and there's lifelessness, there's definitely a feeling of hopelessness there. But with God, all things are possible. Now, the first time that he made that prayer and he put his hands on the boy and he remained cold, how many of us would give up at that point? And I say that to say this, how many of you have prayers in your life that really you've just given up on? You say, well, that just can't be. It's not going to happen. I'm done with it. You know, at the end of that first prayer, I would have been, how am I going to go down this ladder and tell this woman her boy's dead? And so he prayed again. And then he prayed again. See, that's consistency in our prayer life. And I would say that's the next thing that's missing is consistency. Pray. You want this to be more than a routine meeting? Pray. I want something out of the ordinary. I want something that I can remember for years to come. I want something that I can feast on in the days ahead. If you pray for it and you pray that in faith, I believe God will honor that. I believe that He will give that to us. And so he prayed and kept praying. It wasn't just a little one-worder. It wasn't just a little routine. But he prayed and he dealt with the problem. Now, another thing that you'll find Elijah always did is he dealt in specifics. How many of you, when praying, if you pray for your brothers and sisters here at New Testament, well, bless the church. You know what? That's so generic. It would be written on a white card in black ink. How about, Lord God, bless Brother Larry. Help him. Give him exactly what I need. Move through him. Allow the word to be opened up to him. Help him with what is set before him. Now that's a specific prayer, is it not? With that, and as you go down the pews, I tell you what I do, and I still start up here. This is where Destin Max sat right here. And just go back all the way across the building. That's how I go. I go back here, pray for Sarah and Adam and the baby, and then I cut them over and come back up this way right through here. Now that's just how I do it. Bless the church ain't enough. It's not specific enough. It's not helpful enough. It doesn't go before the throne of grace as it should. And if you just say, bless the church, that's about all you get. You know, and the health issues that Brother Junior has had recently, do you think bless the church is enough to say on his behalf? See, we need to get down to where prayer means something to us again. That's specific, and that we know within ourselves that it moves the very hand of God. Verse 21, and he stretched himself upon the child three times, cried unto the Lord, and said, O Lord my God, I pray thee, let the child's soul come unto him again. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came into him again, and he revived. Now drop down to 1 Kings 18 and verse 30. 1 Kings 18 and verse 30. And Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. Now, I'll give you some good, sound, spiritual advice tonight. You need to repair the altar that is broken down. Now, one thing I found, and I understand what they're saying. I really do. The church, if you can call it that I grew up in, they always had a little bench up here, and that's where you went to pray. Now, part of that is borrowed from the Catholic. Part of it is borrowed from Judaism. But the altar is your pride. You know why people don't like something like that? And I understand, there's a lot of Catholic connotations to that. But the problem is people don't like to do this. That's the problem. So if we don't have one, we don't have to do it, right? That is the real problem. So if you want prayer, you find some place to kneel down and some place that you can meet with God. And I would say most of the problem today is we have a broken altar, if you know what I mean. I don't mean a broken down table that we kneel before, but I mean we have a broken prayer life and pretty much we're satisfied with it. You know what? God's people ought not to be satisfied with a so-so prayer life, but many times they are. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto him whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. Now, I want you to see that he became very specific in his praying. Each one of those stones representing a tribe of Israel. You know what? We need to be very specific in our praying. We've got 5 days we've set aside to seek the face of God in revival. Have you prayed for the 10th, the 11th, the 12th, the 13th, and the 14th? Have you prayed specifically for those days? That's what the prayer life of Elijah would have been. Have you prayed for Brother Tom in the way that you should have done that? Have you put him before and said, Lord, fill his mind with the very thing that we need. Open his mind to study. Send the Holy Ghost his way that he might know what we stand most in need of. Have you prayed along those lines? That's what we need. That's what we stand in need of. That's like the prayer life of Elijah. And so he prepared, he made preparations. Verse 33, he put the wood in order. Now, we need things in order. We need things to be done decently. He put them as the Jewish law called him to do, in a specific order. And he put the wood in order and cut the bullock in pieces and laid him on the altar and said, fill 4 barrels with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And he said, do it again the second time. And they did it again the second time. And he said, do it again the third time. And they did it the third time. Now, what the water represents to me is their lack of belief. There was a barrel for each tribe. And they already didn't believe it was possible. And 12 50-gallon drums of water, now they believed it even less. You know what those 12 drums are for us today? Oh, it's the last day. I have to work that week. I'm going to get there as many nights as I can. I hope the baby behaves while I'm there. I hope I don't have to do this. That is your 12 barrels. You need to set those aside and dump them out and let God meet with us. And I say that in the sense, if God meets with us, he'll meet with us. I understand that. But we need to make preparations. We need to be ready. And listen, you won't get prepared doing this right here. You know what that'll make you do? It'll make you faster at your game or faster with your electronic device. But it won't do anything to benefit the kingdom of God. And so we as the Lord's people, we need to make effective preparations and be ready for whatever the Lord may send our way. And so he did that. In verse 35, the water ran around about the altar and filled the trench also with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, this is his prayer, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel. He was identifying who he called out to. What does the Bible say that we are to pray in? In the name of Jesus. But we are calling on the very same God. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. In the name of Jesus. You know why we have merit? Because you know what? You're not Jewish, I'm not Jewish, nobody in here is Jewish. So we go on the merit of Christ and Christ alone. And so when we began to call, when he began to pray, he called on the God that he knew. He called on the very God of all the universe. He named him out. He called on the very God of all heaven. Then he says, and I am thy servant. Notice what he didn't say, and he was. Many areas in the Bible refers to him as Elijah the prophet. Here he says, I'm your servant. Elijah, your servant. Larry, your servant. All I can do is what you ask me to do, and more so than that, I'm willing to do what you ask me to do. That's a servant's heart. That's one that says, whatever you do, I'll be glad to help with it. I'll be glad to get the job done. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art God. Hear me, O Lord, hear me. See, that's two separate times he said that. In other words, you know, we need to keep praying. Hear me, hear me, hear me. You know what? What we do, we get up from prayer time way too quick. It's like instant potatoes. I don't like instant potatoes. Donald loves them. The kids love them. I don't like instant potatoes. I never have. I got burned out on them as a kid, I guess. But that's kind of potatoes most people like. Just that quick. You know what? That's not good prayer life. Prayer is not instant. Prayer takes time. Prayer, you think about non-instant potatoes. You got to wash them and peel them. Boil them and mash them, and in most eyes, like, well, you know, these taste better anyway, and I get to avoid all that. Well, it's that instant thing, and that's what we want about prayer life, isn't it? Just one, two, three, voila. That's not real prayer life. That's not what will get a hold of the throne of grace. It never has been, and it never will be. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. He wanted them to know that they were returning back to God. And the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. That's a result of prayer. It wasn't eloquent, it wasn't long, didn't have a lot of, you know, woo-hoo into it. It was just a heartfelt prayer. You know what? We need to be a people who is known for prayer. Think about all the times that the Lord Jesus says that he went out apart. He left the group, he went out apart to pray. And I think a lot of times when you get in a big group, your mind is so distracted on other things that you just have to withdraw sometime and say, you know what, I need a few minutes by myself and go and pray before the Lord. Do you want something out of the ordinary for next week? That is what it's going to take. And more so than the meeting that's set before us, if you want to walk closely to the Lord in this time that we live, that's what it's going to take anyway, whether we're having a meeting or not. I really look through November and think bad things are going to get worse. I really do. And you may say, well, our pastor's a Debbie Downer. see either one of it working out real well, do you? So, the best thing you can have is a very tight prayer life. Because it just may be we wake up one day and your money is worth nothing. And your electronic banking system has been shut down. And you have whatever's in the cupboard, and when it's gone, it's gone. That'll bring you to your knees, won't it? Sad that we take that, but it did for Israel, didn't it? It did for Israel.